until lunch, and everyone who wants to communicate is free to ask questions and to set discussions. So, please.
Okay, thanks. I'm very pleased to be here having this opportunity to talk to you because I presume that you will now start to work with students on the day round, because I said previously that I want to go a bit to the side from that, because for me, as you will see from some dates on references, this is a pretty old stuff. In the end, I will talk a bit about analogies and where I want to go and where I think it is. When I started to work on these things, 16 years ago or something like this, I, after a while, had the impression that, well, yes, this is some island I have found. Someone else, in reality, Alexei Bogdanov from Donetsk, whom I met in 2000, had found it, and then I thought, okay, it's not a continent. And then after a while, nothing happened, because we wrote paper and nothing happened. As a theoretician predicting something, still nothing happened, I thought, okay, Mount St. Helens, so some isolation in the southern Atlantic. But now I think it's not a continent, but it's a Borneo. It's a jungle, and there are really lots of opportunities. These are the simple things, and this is a skirmion which has not been found yet. This is a skirmion in a certain crystal class which has a strange property that it has this sort of thing. If you go around it, then you rotate the spin, the plane part of it, against the sense of rotation. So you go positively, but the spin rotates in the other way, and then it has this strange sort of thing, which, if you think about this, would be a ferromagnetic film. Where something like this sits inside. This would have then some magnetostatic charges with a pretty interesting distribution, because as you see, the divergency of this in this direction is there, but here it looks more like what we call a Bohr wall. Here it looks like a ring wall. So it depends in which direction the crystal
is. This is more there's a half symmetry.
Yeah. So this sort of symmetry should be there, and this is a simulation of something where a skirmion lattice appears in 0 feet, which has also not been completely seen. There are some data from Felser group, whom you may know, Claudia's Felser's group, Ajay and Maya, which may be something like that. So a skirmion lattice and a magnetic film, which exists in 0 feet, not stabilized. But it's a half command. So, what I want to do now is to introduce this really a bit like illustrative examples and definitions, and explain a bit why it is exciting from a very fundamental simple theoretical point of view to have some such particle-like things in a continuum. I speak a bit about where we are in chiral magnets to make something like this, and briefly come back to this problem of material science problem. This is really only like telling you that where we are currently working. And then I want to come to these analogies of Zaluschinsky models. Everything we have been doing in this field was essentially classical physics. We just used the order parameter, ferromagnetic order, three-component vector, and then switched off some symmetries which usually one took for granted in this classical field of micromagnetism, so your continuum distribution of a spin polarized spin polarization and magnetization, which you calculate just as a classical field. And then the spin orbit coupling results in the so-called Zaluschinsky Maria interactions, which make that you have a chiral twisting, and the ground state of these things is not a simple ferromagnet. This is, from a fundamental point of view of Landau theory, something pretty interesting, because you start with an order parameter and say, okay, ferromagnetism, And then macroscopically you get a helical state in the manganese silicon, which is at the qubit chiral magnet, and macroscopically it behaves like an antiferromagnet. And I will, in the end, when I speak about the analogies, tell you that, or try to insinuate to you that if we use Landau theory as a guide, we may really see much more of this jungle, which is in principle there. At a bit unexpected corner of physics, namely Landau theory of continuous phase transitions, I would have presumed that this is something which is ready, which is complete, it's like a whole story, but just outside of Landau theory of continuous phase transition exists these things, and so these are these skirmions. And once you have this, you are somewhere where we presume to be. I read your announcement that this is hard solid state theory seminar. And I must apologize, this will be not hard theory. And I will speak a lot about soft matter.
So relative term.
Yeah, so in reality, these things exist then as particles in two dimensions. They have a certain extension, therefore we say they are in a static soliton, and you can arrange them however you want them. Because they are stable, they are physically stable, they have a certain size and a certain energetics which stabilizes them. You can make, for instance, crystals out of them. In two dimensions, crystallization will not really happen, so in reality you will have a different arrangement, something like hexatic order or some quasi long-range order or something like this. And I think in many experiments also show something like this, that these lattices, so-called skirmion lattices, are in reality a bit more complicated and not so nicely ordered. But you could also make liquids, and you can have them also as excitations of a collinear ferromagnet. Think you have a ferromagnetic film, very thin, with low, huge anisotropy. But these chiral interactions, which I will present a bit later, are there which stabilize skirmions. Then you can have these things as nonlinear excitations. And they are just sitting at some place where you have created them in your film. And because this film may be ideal, very clean, whatever, magnetic material, you can move them around easily. And this is one of the attractions of these things. Now, skirmion. If we say skirmion, it's not only a multidimensional soliton, so, but it is also a topological soliton. So it has a topological index. This means on top of being physically stable, which we require that we have a soliton solution of some field equation for our classical field, in our case, three component vectors, we have also a topological stabilization. The relation between these two things is not so clear-cut, because I will in the end show you that we may have such textures with something of an order parameter where it looks like a skirmion, but in reality it is topologically not stable anymore. So you have this feature which we call double twist. Here I started already explaining this, so I go radially outward and it rotates the magnetization vector from down to up. But if I go around this here in the middle where the magnetization is in plane in this film, I rotate also. And this is called in liquid crystal theory double twists. And this is a very well known thing, double twist tubes in chiral nematics and so called local hysterics, which are just helical arrangement of what like molecules, which make also a helix like this and can have also this double twist. So now I have a definition, and the question was, when I ran into Alexei Bogdanov, who had invented this and has seen it in my point of view as the first one, that really you can have something like this in a very classical system like micromagnetism, just ferromagnetic order parameter, and you can have localized excitations. How do we stabilize this? Normally a magnet doesn't. So if you have a two-dimensional magnetic system, just exchange isotropic and the magnetization vectors should be parallel, that shouldn't exist. But twisting, so the non-collinearity, which seems at the root of all this thing, comes in two different ways in magnetism. there are two different ways how we can introduce such modulated states. And I use here a scheme invented, or first clearly spelled out by Deschenes maybe, that you can have when you use Landau theory. You can have a chiral, a helical magnetic structure in two different ways. You can have something like this, that you have a J1, J2 model, say XY model, which the exchange competes here, which forces that this magnetization cannot stay collinear and makes a helical arrangement. In that case, everything is still simple, and the helix which can be there will be one of the types that right turning and left turning are energetically degenerate, and this would be an exchange frustrated system. In that case, Landau theory, at least for this one-dimensional axial structures like there are Earth simple crystals, which are hexagonal, works very fine, and the magnetic phase transition from the paramagnetic state in the helix works just that the amplitude of this helix, the expectation value just grows. So you, normal Landau theory in that case works fine. Still, one can imagine that even for this type of structures, one could have something like skirmiotes, which would be really microscopically small, because usually this frustration of the exchange makes it that these helices have very short pitch. And there are some attempts by our future former student Andrei Leonov and Mostovoy, Maximus Mostovoy, to integrate certain magnetic behaviors, multi-Q structures which are like spherical magnetics. The other thing where it is very clear that from the basic theory, from the phenomenology, that you have localized, really localized states, comes from Zaluzhinsky in a very famous paper about incommensurate structures of 1964, where he explains this, that you can have in certain chiral magnets incommensurate states where the competition between the antisymmetric exchange, which comes by spin orbit coupling, the spin is not a good quantum number, results from exchange and some slight twisting, and just distorting the normal ferromagnetic or antiferromagnetic order. And in that case, he shows that one gets a one-dimensional helical states as ground states. If there are anisotropies, say easy axis anisotropy, the helix cannot go round and round, but it will rotate in a 180-degree fashion and then stay for a certain time, say in the easy axis direction, and then you get the soliton. And it shows that these are really solitons, so one-dimensional localized states. There are a number of materials here, also antiferromagnets, where something like this has been seen. And we are here. Phenomenological theory of magnetism for such systems, which we now started to call Zaluzhinsky models, allow you to have skirmiums in the sense I'm talking about. Here you see where it comes all from, so it's an effect of spin orbit coupling, you have the direct exchange and the antisymmetric exchange, and these two exchanges by linear terms compete with each other. This would turn the spins by 90 degrees to each other, and it's a weak term because it comes from spin orbit, and this is a strong term. And it was first conjectured to, by Zaluzhinsky simply by looking at symmetry to explain some small magnetization in nominally antiferromagnetic materials, which has, had been found further previously. This is weak ferromagnetism. And Moria explained this within a microscopic super-exchange formalism. So this is the microscopic reason for what I'm telling you about. But this sort of non-collinearity exists in very many crystals. This is in almost all multi-sub lattices, you will have something like this, magnets. So in ferromagnets, antiferromagnets, and so on. And it is usually a small effect, but it can have sometimes drastic consequences. Now, in certain magnets, some effective Zaluzhinsky-Moria coupling will remain, which makes that from lattice cell to lattice cell you rotate the spin in the same direction by a small angle. And only in these crystals, I will later show you which these are crystal classes, you will have this chiral magnetism. They must be, first of all, acentric. They cannot have a center of symmetry. So now these are the ingredients, non-collinear magnetism. And a simple model which shows this from an isotropic acentric system is then described by Zaluszynski for cubic, this would apply for cubic crystals, by having just a magnetization vector. This would be some unit vector here. This is the modulus of the magnetization. Here I have written the direct exchange as such a Cartesian term in a more complicated fashion. And here I would have the Bohr-Norman-Landau expansion, like a 5-4 theory for the magnitude of the order parameter, the modulus. And here I have a term which is this Zaluszynski-Moyer interaction adapted for the isotropic or cubic case. That's why it is written in this very compact form. And you see that this is linear in a Cartesian term, and it is reflecting chirality of this crystal system, the acentric nature, that there is no inversion symmetry in this, by being anti-symmetric by this vector product with a Cartesian term. And this is an important term. It is very low order. It's not some complicated coupling with a higher number of gradients. It's linear in the gradient, and this changes everything about our presumptions, what can appear as structures in the order parameter field. In that case, just the magnetization vector. Now, Alexei Bogdanov, with whom I had the pleasure to work for a long time and learned almost all these things, he wrote a paper in 1989 where he predicts that in certain acentric crystallographic classes you can have so-called vortices. Now we tell them skirmions, if you have such terms. And here he has hidden in this Hamiltonian or free energy or whatever you would call it, he has hidden a Zaire-Lifschitz invariant, this term which is linear in gradients just in such a term here. This is the very simple theory which we use, and this contains all these strange things. Now, how does it work, and where is the basic problem? If you have, this is something how he looked at this, and I want to explain this to you a bit. If you have such a continuum theory which has a gradient term squared, the usual elastic energy of the exchange, and a potential term. So almost all Ginzburg-Landau theories will look like this in all our condensed matter theories for ordered orientable states will look like this. And you have a field like this. There's a very hard theorem from field theory from Derrick, and later expanded by Robert and others. By simple scaling, you can see that you can have only one-dimensionally localized states. So only wall-like objects can be localized. Localized means they have finite energy, they must decay to the ground state or one of the degenerate vacuum states fast enough. And they should be continuous, there should be no defect. This means the skirmions as two-dimensional objects cannot fall under this. There must be exception. And the usual condensed matter theories, which we use all the time to explain things, usually have only this type of elastic gradient term and this one. Now, how does it work? The role of the Lifschitz invariants, one can look, see if one looks really at the scaling properties of such functionals. So I have an energy functional which depends on the continuous field and which is squared in gradients. This is phi 2. And the usual term would be a potential term, which is has no gradient term. This is written a bit strangely like this here. And I have these antisymmetric Lifschitz invariants, which are linear in the gradient. So I have three terms. And then I assume that I have a localized solution of the field here, U, and do some rescaling exercise. So I rescale it just with a common factor. This was Derrick's proof. But he had not this term. And Alexei Bogdanov looked at something like this, but knew that such terms are allowed, Lilia and Katjens, and saw that this changes everything. Namely, if you have then a scaling factor lambda and your equilibrium solution should be at the scaling factor lambda, you can count these energy terms here. If you insert the field u of x into these energy terms and just count the powers, then you get for a one-dimensional localized state, so a kink-like object here, you get three terms like this, which scale with this lambda scaling factor in this fashion. So 1 over lambda, and this means one-dimensional localized objects can exist and are stable because you stay here at the energy mode minimum. And this term, which comes from Lifshitz invariant, from the first order gradient terms, is not important because these two terms compete. So the exchange and the potential term. Now, if you localize it in two dimensions, like a skirmion or a vortex, here it is called baby skirmion, then you see that you would have from the gradient term just a constant, and from the potential term something which scales with the size of this object like lambda squared. This is a parabola which ends at zero, and this means such things would be unstable. If you have a Lifshitz invariant, then it is stable. This is this term. And you can have even three-dimensional localized objects, and something like this has been at least calculated by Philip Rybakov from Ekaterinburg. He has an interesting and nice paper where he shows something like this for magnetic models. You can have at least metastable states which are localized in three dimensions, such hedgehogs or scapulites. So this term, which is linear in the order parameter field, in our case magnetization, and which comes microscopically from Samyshinsky-Moria interactions, is an important thing. And it changes the game of stabilizing textures. You can have really multidimensional localized states. Now, Alex Bogdanov then went on and showed that really in a realistic model of a chiral magnet, which is uniaxial, a magnetic field stabilizes in some such skirmion lattice state as thermodynamic phase. So all eccentric crystals which allow this coupling can have skirmions just as excitations, but it is not sure that you easily find them, and it's actually easier to look where there are some stable thermodynamic state where they show up. And this was a proof that one can really look for these things. These are uniaxial crystals of a certain class where an applied field stabilizes in a state where such tubes will be packed together, running along the axis with the magnetization down in the center, and on this honeycomb lattice around the magnetization is up, and naturally it will be for energetic reason because they are stable, it will be compressed together and form a densely packed array. Then it took some time and we wrote still something about cubic helium magnets, and that there are also some such states, and analyzed this and predicted that close to the ordering transitions conditions may be quite right to find something like this. And then it took still a bit of time and finally it was also really found. Now where's the problem to find this? Because if you look at this, you would think it should have been seen already many years ago. Because eccentric magnetic materials were known a long time and people looked at it and usually didn't find much interesting. The manganese silicon, these cubic crystals, this is an intermetallic compound, was known as a chiral helium magnet since 1980. So Zaluschinsky had to wait from 1964 when he predicted this to a magnetic realization when it was realized until 1980. In 1989, Alexei Bogdanov predicted that in such crystals also skirmions should exist, and it took then until 2006, 7 or 8, or depending on when there was clear experimental evidence. So there's always a certain lag between theory, prediction, and until one copes. The problem why this is not so easily seen is seen here. In these isotropic or cubic helium magnets, if you apply field, ground state changes in the following fashion. You have the helix running in a certain direction, which is determined by weak anisotropy, small energy terms. If you apply field, the helix just tilts with its propagation direction in field direction and becomes slightly conical. By this you win Zeeman energy and still do not perturb much the helix. And this is in the magnetic phase diagram at low temperatures, this is the only state you get. You do not get this field in plus coming. In the meantime, we have shown that under certain conditions, you get skirmion lattices with the magnetization up in the center and down at the border, or the other way around. Or you get half skirmion lattices where you have only half of a skirmion, so the topological charge, which I will not introduce in detail, some of you may know this better than I, is here one half of such a bracket, but there must be a defect here. For this reason, and this is a staggered thing, so magnetization is up, up, down, down, in such an antiferromagnetic exchange of a square lattice. Such state exists, but they usually must require some extra energy terms to be stable against the normal helicoid and the conical state. These are the extended textures where, which build up magnetic phase diagrams. And it is crystal class which has been investigated so far. Mainly one has investigated just found magnetic phase diagrams which only have this one-dimensional modulated state. Now localized states, as I said, exist in all these materials as excitations, and this is one of the things which we want to have. And here's the early model which we wrote about skirmions in a ferromagnetic film, where you have the Lifshitz invariant, which I have now written in this form. This is a complete form, which is somehow induced by the surface. So this constant, the material constant, through the thickness of the film running from Z plus minus one here in this case variables, is somehow depending how deep you are in the film. This is for a thicker film where the inversion symmetry breaking, which allows this interaction to appear, is localized at the surface. All surfaces naturally break inversion symmetry, so even in normal magnetic materials, you will have something like that. And this was in some numerical solution that something like this can exist. The important term in this whole game is this one. This is the anisotropy which suppresses the chiral modulation of this state and makes that you have an easy access out of plane magnetization behavior. This model was then for a positive K, and then you can have such localized excitations, which for topological and energetic reasons should then be the same. Now, this means you can suppress the magnetic twisting by this Zaluschinsky-Moreau interactions also out of plane, and you can suppress the conical state. And then we have just done this usual game that one investigates all these magnetic phase diagrams and so on. And this is for a film of a cubic helimagnet, some part of the magnetic phase diagram, where we came up this easy axis anisotropy here from zero to some state. So here you recognize this type of phase diagram which I told you about. Ground state is a helix. When I apply a field out of plane, you get the conical state, and finally the cone flips and makes a ferromagnetic state. If you have this uniaxial anisotropy, we showed that somewhere this field-induced skirmion lattice wins against the cone, and you can have this. And this is one of the possible mechanisms why in thin films of manganese, silicon, iron, germanium, these B20 materials, which are the Guinea peak of this physics or this micromagnetic game, you find sometimes skirmions. There may be other terms which do it. And then you can do the magnetization processes and analysis, and this is all very necessary to explain to experimentalists what they see. And they believe it or not, in reality, we, at the moment, we do not really know why in some of these films skirmions have been seen and others not. the measurements on these films, this is secondary effects, a cubic film distorted in some way or having a surface anisotropy or other extra terms, just shifts the equilibrium between spermiomatics and such a conical state. I want to make only one important point here. For the experimentalists to have this game of pearls that they have skirmions in the film and can move them around, they should not be here in this low anisotropy region, they should be here in the high anisotropy region, where the magnetic state is just a collinear out of plane magnetized state. And this material we do not have at the moment, no one has it. Either they see skirmions somehow, maybe field induced, but they should be here. In a high anisotropy region and still have this Zaluszynski-Moria, then you can make this. And this is one of the challenges at the moment. That one should have a material which is highly anisotropic and has this Zaluszynski-Moria. And because this is the same effect at the microscopic level, usually in magnetic metallic systems, the anisotropy comes from the exchange. And the antisymmetric exchange is also there. There are certain relations between these terms. And so it may be not so easy to find a suitable material for that. Because usually the Zaluszynski-Moria is a first order effect of the, this is for the experts, for the from the spin orbit coupling. And the anisotropy second order, which means that you are usually staying here, not here. Another thing which I want to come back to is the Shente
scheme. You have systems, you know, similar to where sometimes the linear terms can cancel, but you have cubic order, and then in that case you could be flipped.
Yeah, or you have just, you see, this works like this, that the Zaluszynski-Moria looks like this. And the exchange is, and the exchange anisotropy term looks like this. So now if you have like J1, J2, you have a D1, D2, this here adds up only, while this can compete. So you can have something like this, and the Zaluszynski vector along a chain or a certain direction is like this for this bond, but like this for this bond, and you have strong anisotropy, but you need further neighbor interactions. So there's hope that you can somehow design something like this, but I think you need to understand what you are doing if you are searching for something like that. So, yeah, now I'm at this point of having skirmions as free particles. It's like evaporation. And there's an important point which I already started to explain with this Deschenes scheme. You can have a certain order of something by just cranking up the amplitude. So in the helix or in the skirmion lattice can grow from the paramagnetic background or from some other state just by increasing the amplitude of it somehow. But for a skirmion lattice, because you have this localized state, this is not like a continuous phase transition usually works. This is not this mode instability. You have a mode which grows spontaneously from zero, like in a continuous phase transition. You can have a continuous phase transition by just creating one skirmion in a collinear ferromagnetic state. Because in the thermodynamic limit, this perturbation is localized, it still has a measure of zero, it has no white, and you add the next skirmion and the next to make a continuous phase transition. You change the topology by this project. So you just switch stepwise, each state which you create in your film has a different topological index sum, but it is still thermodynamically continuous phase transition. This is what Deschenes calls this nucleation transition. And this is really realized and has been seen in experiment. In the reverse process, you just start with a skirmion lattice and crank up the field, then the core of the skirmion will shrink, And the skirmions finally start to repel each other. They have repulsive interaction, and the lattice parameter diverges. And at the transition, when the energy density of this lattice is equal to the paramagnetic state or the ferromagnetic spin polarized paramagnetic state, you have infinite radius of the single skirmion. This is a continuous phase transition. Still, the topological entities are preserved. They are never destroyed in this process. In a real experiment, actually, you have not an infinite film. So you just push the skirmions out, or they stay somewhere in defects also in state. So that if you speak to an experimentalist and propose how it can look by macroscopic measurement that there could be skirmions, they should just do the races to ever higher fields, because then they see that skirmions or bubbles or some magnetic entities reappear when you come back to this and condense together to a lattice again. So this is a completely different thermodynamic transition than the type of which we are accustomed to in normal paramagnetic, ferromagnetic order, disorder, and similar phase transitions, where you just grow in amplitude your order. Here, finite size objects appear, and they have a certain stability already when they appear as fluctuations.
So, but if these objects are, say, topological excitation, topological invariant, then how can I push them out? I mean, if I have a finite system, at some point they cannot
be canceled. They fall over the cliff, they have to go out at the border of the system. I mean, topological system without support at the edge of your film, they just must be pushed out. This is exactly what happens here with the lattice parameter. So in the reverse process, it's just you evaporate this lattice and the distance between skirmion and horse becomes infinite. So yeah, the lattice widens ever further, and by this the number of skirmion per unit area in your film will vanish continuously. In a finite film, actually, you have just the edge of the film where the skirmion may be pushed out. If it's possible, I mean, there are some intricacies that it may be held back by the surface.
Do they have the same? Oh, sorry?
You can also create them in kinks, right?
Yeah. This is the same process like soliton lattice. So soliton lattice also doesn't disappear by destroying of the soliton, these kinks. Just the domains in between the kinks become increasingly larger, and finally the size of these domains diverges. It's exactly the same process.
How would the mobility change as you increase the field? Would it get worse?
If you have pinning, the usual thing is that some of these objects just stay put and you will never get rid of them. This is something which how it really works. And this is one of the reasons that in such continuous phase transitions, which are from the thermodynamic reasoning, are continuous, like this here, you will see hysteresis. This is a pinning effect. So hysteresis for these things doesn't mean that the phase transition is first order. This is counterintuitive, but here, because you have these localized stable objects, everything changes and you have to look afresh at these things. So exactly, if you have pinning and some disorder, then these things are not mobile anymore. And the thermodynamic forces pushing these things apart in these models are very low, because the elastic interaction is transmitted by the exchange and decays exponentially. So not long-range forces anymore between these things. So we have no really driving force after a while that these things disappear. Okay, this is how it really looks. This is experiments from Tokugawa's group on such a B20 material. This was on an alloy which has a relatively large helix. There you see in Lorentz microcraft some helices. And then at the intermediate field range, these helices break up and you get such a skirmion lattice. And finally, at high fields, they saw exactly what I told you, that some such skirmion spots remain. And they just do not disappear. This is, in the magnetization curve, you would see that it behaves like a ferromagnet, but these defects, then they are really like excitations, they just stay in the field. And this was some conference thing where we just explained a few of these basic things like that. Okay? Now, as I said, we had first predicted a bit that near the ordering transition in the bike material, something like this may be also visible. This was naturally not out of the blue because it was known that manganese silicon has an anomalous phase transition from the paramagnetic thread into this ignis. And the idea of this whole game is something which is very important for this type of theories, namely that the longitudinal magnitude of the order parameter, so the modulus of magnetization, and the directional part, the twisting, the direction of the unit, of the magnetization vector, cannot be disentangled. If you write down this theory and look at the Euler equations, you see that these two things are always coupled. This means that near the ordering transition, if you twist and have some incompatibility, some frustration, and in this theory there is some frustration, then near the ordering transition also the modulus will be large, where you have a large gain of energy by this double twist, where you exploit the Zaluzhinsky-Moria interaction best by twisting in different direction, but it will shrink and vanish eventually towards paramagnetic background, where you have energetically, locally unfavorable texture, so non-collinearity of your texture. And this is explained here in this graph, that you have a skirmion with a fixed modulus artificially from such a Landau theory plus Lifshitz invariant, which encodes the Zaluzhinsky-Moria interaction, and you go radially outward and you see, look at the integrated energy density over radius. This would be the case of a skirmion with a fixed modulus, the green curve, and this would be the helix. And if you then finally reach at the radius the R here, the downward magnetization in that case, this is without field, just as excitation, you see that also you have here in the core a gain of energy with respect to the helix by this double twist. You use the Zaluzhinsky-Moria interaction better. You end up here at the outskirts by a positive excess energy, which means that this state is not stable with respect to the helix. You cannot have something like that. But if you allow the modulus of magnetization to vary, then you get this integrated energy curve and you can win eventually against the helix. So by simply modifying the model a bit and allowing that you shrink the magnetization modulus locally, the expectation value of spin polarization, one would say, and that does this clearly with a microscopic theory, you would have energy gain. This is not completely new from the phenomenological point of view. It is well known and has been even experimentally shown if you have a very large uniaxial anisotropy magnet. And look at the magnetic domain walls in the bulk. They should be at low temperatures always like Bloch walls. But at high temperatures they transform into easing walls where the magnetization stays just in the easy axis direction but shrinks in magnitude and goes to zero. So near, if you have such terms which are square in the order parameter and anisotropic or antisymmetric, you may have textures, so distribution of magnetization, which generate defects.
And they will fight with the isolated skirmions.
You may also make textures out of this, so you will get near the ordering temperatures defect ordered states where you have zeros, and I will presently show this. So, in the historical development, then there was this quasi-universal phase diagram of manganese silicon. Here's temperature, here's magnetic field, and there were some pockets of magnetization where one knew already since the 90s that the magnetization modulation is strangely not like here in the conical state along the magnetic field, but perpendicular to the magnetic field. This was known already beginning of 1990s. But then it didn't, so Bentele Beck from Riese did such experiments, But no one further did something about this. Then came Flatterer Group. They knew about us because we had worked of, with Flatterer, and they really looked. And they claimed then that this here is a scorpion lattice. By looking at magnetic small angle neutron scattering with looking at the modulation, looking at the modulation of the magnetic order along the beam. So they look with a field along the beam and look at track intensity satellites which come by this modulation of the magnetization, and saw such six-fold pattern appearing in this region. Simultaneously, Catherine Pappas did experiments here in zero field and showed that there are some fully chiral, quasi-static magnetic structure before really the helix comes. She did polarized neutron experiments and said there's about 1 Kelvin or less than 1 Kelvin interval of a texture, magnetic texture, which is which can be seen by polarized neutrons and is some magnetic state which could be liquid-like. Something like this we had in mind. This here we thought is also possible, but the main thing would be that in this state the magnetization modulus would be inhomogeneous, and some of these subphases which appear there could be something like defected states, very complicated objects which are similar to the conical state, because we knew also from experiments from St. Petersburg group that in this region where these anomalies appear by thermodynamic measurements, there's still a modulation also along the field, like you would expect in the conical state. And so this paper was ornamented with a theory which claimed that this is only a superposition of three helices, which is kind of very strange, because the three helices are in this model which everyone uses and believes to be correct, is never a state. It's a completely unstable state, cannot exist. What would exist would be a scorpion lattice, but if it was a true lattice, because of this non-linearity of the object, then higher order peaks should appear in the magnetic structure. But they were never seen properly, or if they have been seen, they are much too small. So, in my point of view, this claim that here is a scorpion lattice is, let's say, very optimistic. This was, so to say, something which is, so to say, the daring step of just telling something which has a ring of plausibility, but which is not really clear from the point of view of theory. We didn't expect that the conditions are so simple, because we knew also that this area where something like this is seen depends on samples very strongly, has some subdivision, and behaves generally not like a normal phase, and such a phase of three superposed spiral state would be just another Landau-like phase. Now, why is it so? I have to introduce now this thing about confinement of scorpions, which we did some time ago. This is still a hanging issue for us. The issue is that in low temperatures, when the modulus of magnetization is hard, so what we call micromagnetic regime, so the saturation magnetization locally is well established and the magnetization is stiff, the spin polarization. Scorpions interact by repulsion and with a short-range repulsion. This is a normal behavior of scorpions, and in these cubic Kelly magnets you would have here only conical state. You can have still hexagonal scorpion lattices, metastable state. If you have scorpions in this temperature range at reduced temperatures here, around the ordering temperatures, scorpions tend to cluster and they behave generally much more complicated because they interact by oscillatory forces. I will presently show this, but there are certain distances where they interact strongly attractively. And scorpions have not a fixed modulus, as I showed you. So, really, radial solution of scorpion and would look like this, that the magnetization of the radius, this is this red curve, has a slight change over the radius. As I said, they are become large where this double twist, this is a spring about here, favors the energetics of this object, of this polynomial object. This is the profile, the tilt angle theta going from the center outwards. These are numerical solutions, there are no analytical solutions possible in this whole game of theory. This is a normal fermion, and because this decay of this parameter is here exponentially, asymptotically, one can exactly write then how these fermions interact. And the interaction is Kappa CV. So the fermion gains energy, but they are pushed together by this, because you gain energy by filling the space effectively with fermions, but they are repulsing each other. They behave like soft platelets with exponential interaction, repulsive interaction. This is a normal behavior of fermions. Now, a fermion in this, what we call precursor range, looks like this. The modulus oscillates, and also it has some, like a Friedel oscillation, some such ringing tilt angle. This is a theta. And if we have a pair of fermions, they behave like this, that at certain distances they will have favorable distance with respect to each other.
These are fermions in the same direction?
Yeah. This is on a paramagnetic background. The numerical calculations. So in this precursor range, you could imagine that these fermions, just let's say as a small ellipsoidal excitations, are nucleated and fluctuate some part. Your clock is not running yet. How much time do I have?
Oh, no,
it's okay. Just
goes until you stop.
I stop immediately.
No, we start everything
scheduled. So you can imagine that something like this nucleates, but they attract each other. And if they are present, another fermion is there, then they stabilize each other. This means the fluctuation and excitation spectrum of this thing is very, very strange. And the statistical mechanics of something like this is not normal. And this is exactly what we believe Katharine Pappas in her neutron spin echo methods measurements sees, that the dynamics is also strange.
So this is
a real confinement, exactly. These fermions will form, let's say, clusters, or there is a certain clustering which saturates this need to be social, that they do not like to be isolated at high temperatures, but they form clusters and stabilize each other. And there's old theory which says there are some sort of transitions of this kind which are, so to say, a mode instability by localized nucleation. So you nucleate something, but it nucleates better if other such entities are simultaneously present. And this is one of the reasons why we believe that these bike systems are still very interesting, because they create a new type of phase transition which we have not seen yet and not properly analyzed.
Excuse me, but you show different regimes, but can you say what is responsible for what? Or you are playing only with these three interactions?
Anisotropy and then Landau term. And if I use this, I can write the asymptotic form of these interactions, and I can show that these oscillations start to develop and that they are attractive parts.
But this there are some general considerations that in order to have this localized sink, you need some long-range forces, then you have some internal...
There are no long-range forces, nothing. There's no long-range forces. Dipole-dipole interactions we neglected so far, because they are on this scale of a few 10 nanometers, still not very important. For real quantitative theory, they must be included. So,
but you don't have then thallus type of transitions or anything
no.
like that?
No, because you can...
make interactions
no. Okay. So, and using such reasoning with some extension of the theory, we can show that you can have rather different phase diagrams. The important point I want to make is a different, this is a generalized model which has a modified longitudinal stiffness. I did not explain this, so I will also not explain it more in detail. But the important thing is that in zero field, there's also a regime of such a half fermion, that is a staggered thing. In two-dimensional model. But this means this that you have the possibility to make a thermodynamically stable phase also in three dimensions, which has defects. I showed you that this half skolmion arrangement has defects, and it can be more complicated because in the third direction I can still twist, for instance, skolmions around each other, or make some such cross motion and win some energy when I am allowed to have defects. And this is one of the reasons why we believe that in such magnets close to the ordering temperatures there can be more phases, especially phases which have defects. So this is, let's say, the open part of the story. Experimental evidence, we did some experiments, and the St. Petersburg crew did some experiments. This is here with Herbert Wilhelm from Diamond, where we looked at the phase diagram of iron germanium and found from just microscopic measurements some evidence that it's indeed some, let's say, more complicated thing. This here may be a skolmion lattice, there may be here some such regime also in this magnet, which is similar to this manganese-silicon precursor regime. This is important, these are SANS data which show that this phase and this phase are really there and have modulations eventually along the field and perpendicular the field, at least in the high field range. And I believe that this phase is really such a candidate of a defected three-dimensionally twisted arrangement of things. What it is completely open and the experiments are extremely difficult. And because we wanted to be more quantitative, recently we did for a similar model, mainly Helge Rosner or Oleg Janssen, his PhD student, for a similar magnetic material. This has the same crystal structure like manganese silicon, a very detailed ab initio, so density functional plus U plus spin orbit coupling. Calculations of magnetic interactions, including Solushinsky-Moria, some quantum Monte Carlo to have a magnetic equation of state, then we mapped it on a classical Heisenberg model, which we then translated into a continuum theory. And then we started to work on this when we were here. So there's a really quantified microscopic theory and simulated then two-dimensional such textures, and looked how stiff or non-stiff this, using this equation of state here, this is.
Okay, so
the magnetization modulus is slightly modulated, and here in the square lattice you have really a defect, and this exists here somewhere in the mean field phase diagram. This is mean field theory, very primitive. We do not do really Monte Carlo. We assume that a lot of these things are already taken care of for this temperature range by determining the equation of state. In reality, this is a very magnetic and a very complicated thing. We got the Zalushinsky spiral length and the lattice parameter of the skolmion lattice, or this A phase, about correct for this thing. So this means we are on the way to have a more material specific theory under certain conditions. Okay. Briefly, where is the challenge? I think the challenge is that we get rid of this conical phase. And here I show in this scheme all eccentric crystal classes where skolmions can exist for a ferromagnetic order parameter. This is here in this blue ellipse. There, but here in this red, there are crystal classes which have no Lifshitz invariant with a gradient along the axis. And this means this is a realization of this Bogdanov-Hubert phase, this field-induced skolmion lattice at t equals 0. And among other things, tetragonal half-Häusler alloys are either here or maybe here. There are some materials, ferromagnetics, with very high transition temperatures, which show this. I'm sure we'll find something like this, or Claudia Felser's group will find something like this. So there are, these are, for bulk materials, are really the interesting materials which one should look at. The rest, the B20 is here, this is C4T. They all have Lifshitz invariants in all three spatial directions, Cartesian directions, and so you have always this competition with the conical phase. and which is not nice and difficult to handle.
But how is that symmetry breaking in the go back? Yeah. What is breaking the symmetry in those lower, lower symmetry?
They are asymmetric, but they have mirrors which are containing the axis. And this means you cannot have, so they are all of this kind that you have an axis, like the C and V and 4, 6. So you have an axis here in fold. And you have mirrors which are contained in the axis. And so thin films also have this. This is a rush asymmetry, I think, when you're thinking. So, you can have this. In reality, you can have more with Schitt's invariance. In total, you may have nine different ones. And so without any symmetry, you need at least 9 materials parameters to find this. So, and this is the dihedral crystal glass. This is very special because you have this open motion axis.
Yeah, so anything outside the blue circle is non-symmetric, but and doesn't have Delos-Eschenbach interaction and won't have Schrödinger.
These here,
yeah, outside the blue,
they have too high symmetry. They have for a ferromagnetic order parameter no Lipschitz invariance.
So they won't show Delos-Eschenbach interaction and.
There can be Zawiszynski-Moria interactions. It depends where in these crystal glasses you put your magnetic ions. Mm-hmm. And in multi-surfaces they will be there, but there will be never for a ferromagnetic order parameter Lipschitz invariant. This is the difference between microscopic Zawiszynski-Moria is almost everywhere, but mm-hmm. once you have low symmetry sites of magnetic ions in these crystal glasses, but still you will have no such coupling term in the Landau theory. And this is the issue. Okay, so I skip this because I want briefly to go to the last part. Mm-hmm. Analogy. This is, you can read it in the papers. Some in films, you see. This is what with Detmold Chesky. I want to go briefly to composite order parameters. Antiferromagnetics also show this. You have just a vector order parameter, the staggered vector. But there are, again, these crystal glasses here, they are special. And this is also the case of the tetragonal half-Eusslers. They are only reverse. You have always the decanting internally in the unit cell. So you have 2 sublattices, antiferromagnet, and the staggered vector, the antiferromagnetic order parameter will form, say, this is L here, a helix, but you have internally also a canting, this weak ferromagnetism. So the magnetization will, of the 2 sublattices is not collinear intrinsic in each cell. And so in that case, you have along with this helix, you have a longitudinal spin density wave with a weak ferromagnetic moment. The same would be here. There are even materials which show this. Also, bismuth ferrite is a magnetoelectric where the structure is looking like that. And you have this weak ferromagnetism here, which means that you have a handle on this antiferromagnetic material by having this weak ferromagnetic moment. So locally applying a magnetic field will influence the antiferromagnetic helix. And now for skirmions, it means that the skirmion in these crystal glasses will look like this. So this corresponds to this propagation like a cycloid. The skirmion will also look like a cycloid or nail-like. For the order parameter, but there is also a magnetic moment here.
Locally. But the D class is what you said
that has been observed. Not been observed. And here in the center, there must be a defect. There's always a duality between these 2 order parameter parts. And one is the dominant one, and the other is subordinate, and the one which is, so to say, weak or soft, weak ferromagnetism, weak antiferromagnetism, will have defects. So there's a hope, again, in these crystal classes that we have some interesting way of going into antiferromagnetics and influencing them by having external magnetic fields. Now, I told you already there are lots of skirmions elsewhere. Some of you may very well know quantum Hall effect magnets where skirmions exist.
First paper.
The stabilization mechanism is completely different, and you should learn this as a very nice video by Gerwin, where he explains this very nicely. And you have higher order gradient terms or long range forces, depends how you look at it. So completely different.
Those are logarithmic interactions between the skirmishes in that case. So. But then why is that, so why is logarithmic in one and not in use in the classical sense? In the skirmish in here, they have two types.
You have
the one that is the Laughlin quasi particles and the one that are skirmished in the quantum fractal, in the fractal Kamal effect.
This is here from the.
And you go to one,
one. This is a simple one. There is just electromagnetism, and you get in principle higher order gradient terms. You can write it as higher order gradient terms. This is like Skirmish model. Closer to our concerns are the blue phases, and I told you already about this, and this is one of the nematics which are chiral, and where these rod-like molecules form these double twist tubes. And you weave them together in three-dimensional textures, but because this is not a vector, the order parameter, it is a director, so up and is equal to down, you have declination lines as effects. So you have also this is interwoven three-dimensional network in the blue phase, which is a crystalline arrangement of this. We have also these black lines of declination lines. The important point is here that in the quasi-universal phase diagram of such things, here's a chirality, which is ruling the pitch of this twisting. And temperatures, you have a so-called blue phase 3, which is amorphous arrangement of these tubes one believes, and which is from the symmetry point of view not distinguished to the isotropic, so the para phase of these things. There's a critical point here, so you can go around here, you don't break any symmetry. This is a first order line, which means you can have an amorphous liquid like arrangement of these things. And we believe also that something like this exists in these magnets. This is one of the inspirations why we think that the theory of these chiral magnets is incomplete at the moment. You can also use more complicated order parameters with four components, then you can make all skirmions. And I will not go into this, we just speculated a bit about this. This should be still done, but in magnetism, and this talk was announced as magnetism talk, there are no four component order parameters. But you can do this, and it would be fun to find something like this. The nicest thing would be a four component order parameter made of phonons. Then you have just a lattice which makes somewhere some small balls of static phononic distortion. And this would be really the nicest
twist
thing.
Twist or what?
Yeah.
How would they look like?
I don't know how they look, but I hope I find them in the end, maybe in 20 years, and it's a future time like someone finds it. It's not so difficult to imagine where to look. Must be high symmetry materials, but there should be some high component order parameter with modern three components, and you can make such ball-like objects.
But these antiferromagnets, magnets, they can have six orders.
I will presently show you much more. This is some theory Andre Leonov did for his thesis. This looks exactly like these are now four-dimensional skirmions, like the magnetic case. And this is just such a model where you have such terms. I will come now to a more messy case, not four component order parameter, but order parameter with a propagation vector. So if you do Landau theory, you classify your order parameter also with respect to order parameter with a propagation vector, so some vector in the Brillouin zone. And then you look for the little group which keeps the star of this key vectors, propagation vectors constant, or only one arm of it, so a certain propagation vector, you look what sort of other parameters you get. This is a classical way how you do it, and you can learn it in some sort of this classical text, Landau-Lifschitz statistics, I think second volume. And this here would be a spin density wave with two up to down spins, you see it here. And if you allow then, if this is really spin density wave, if you allow the Zaluzhinsky-Moreira interactions in this, you will twist it. And if you look into another classical text, a book by the Toledano brothers on Landau theory, they even discuss such things. And they say, okay, you can have then the Lifshitz invariants for this, because Lifshitz invariants are almost everywhere in this band structure like thing that you classify your Landau theory according to the propagation vector safe at certain high symmetry points. And you have also many of them eventually. So you can twist this spin density wave in different spatial directions. And I just managed to convince our experimentalists, mainly my wife, who has some iron tellur. This is base material of superconductors, is iron-based superconductors, is tetragonal, is centrosymmetric, that they should look at the phase behavior of this. It is known in the phase diagram that there's incumbents and that helical state here at higher doping. And I said, okay, it may not be that this disorder plays a decisive role, because these iron, excess irons which sit somewhere, they seem to be just coupling to this spin density wave like passive things. So they should look above the middle temperature for this transition with Nussbaum efforts. And I wrote down the phenomenological theory, which you can read now. It is now published in PRL, I think this month it came finally out. You just write down the phenomenological theory and show that really you have twisting terms which twists this spin density wave in several spatial directions. You can do double twists, you can do lots of things. But one of these Lifshitz invariants doesn't come from spin orbit doubling. One of them is directly coming from exchange, so it could be large. This is the one which is twisting the, or changing the magnetic order along the propagation vector of the basic primary order parameter. And so you can imagine that you have a twisting of the spin density wave in this direction or in this direction, and the Nussbaum people really find that there is such a precursor behavior over a psi-cycle temperature interval here, which sets in without a noticeable thermodynamic anomaly here, but which seems to be a well-defined temperature where it comes. You see it here, they have here a certain region. They did a nice job of investigating also several examples. And because it's iron containing, one can really show that on the time scale of the Nussbaum experiment, there is some quasi-static magnetic order. But from the diffraction, there's nothing. There's also no thermodynamic anomaly, as I said. So we interpret this as a possibility that in spin density wave or general density wave, order parameters with incumbents of the propagation vector, such effect should be nearly everywhere. Because in that case, you can have usually many such coupling terms. The inversion symmetry is, so to say, broken by the effect that this order parameter is incommensurate. And this is an effect which has been predicted, for instance, by my boss, Gerald van den Brink and Daniel Komsky, for rare earth nickelates. If you have incommensurate or a similar magnetic order, then you have such induced Zhang-Shinsky-like couples. So I believe this is why I said this is a jungle. You can find many systems where something like this exists. This is maybe not the ideal system because it has this disorder here, which is a bit perturbing the system. It would be nicer to have a very clean system and showing this that the phase transition, the thermodynamic one is anomalous. Okay, I come to the conclusions. What I showed you is Lifshitz type couplings in condensed matter systems, just because we find it in magnetism, it is not magnetism, which we have been mainly doing. But as I said, there are many other possibilities, and one should look at this, and maybe there are some surprises now. I explained a bit why it is so exceptional to have this multidimensional static electrons, and then discussed a bit this analogy very briefly. Not this with type 2 superconductors, but the physics of this mesophase is certainly similar. They are like elastic lines pushed together by interactions, and they are in some sense maybe even simpler than type 2 superconductors, because the interactions between them are short range. Main problem, and that's why I announced this is material science talk also, is we do not have really nice material moment to study this skirmion lattice in the bulk at low temperatures, for instance, and the elastic behavior of them, their collective motions and so on. It this temperature interval in this precursor range is much too narrow and experiments extremely difficult. Then I explained a bit about this precursor and confinement and why I believe there is something missing to be learned there. Okay, and with this, I thank you for your attention.
Please, questions?
So about the precursor state, what do you mean about when you say non-topological? What do you mean? Topological, non-topological?
Because the states are soft and the order parameter can go to zero, you can freely change the topology. There's no stability in the classical sense that you do homotopy theory. You can still write something like local topology on the numbers, for instance, but they change all the time. They are really fluctuating entities in this state. For instance, here in this state. So if you have such a defect here, the order parameter passes through zero, you can also just drop out this half skirmion here, then you would, this would be a skirmion state zero if you sum the skirmion number over this error here, but you can have also fractional skirmion number densities. It doesn't make much sense anymore to have this. Now, in the case of this spin density wave order parameter, there's another instability, which is a very funny one. You see, the spin density wave has a phase factor as a degree of freedom. And so you can do that, you can revert the order parameter by just turning, rotating really the spin density in space, like this. But you can also just change the phase in this direction, and then you go also from this state to this state. So, now, as an excitation, such a phase-changing excitation would be a Poisson kink-like excitation. And if you run it through this state here, you get rid of this topological stability. This is normally from field theory or from some helium textures. This has been discussed as this Alice behavior. So you see the grinning cat, something is still there, but you can go another way around and see that it is not really stable. So you can destroy order which topological order which is presumed to be there if you look only at the direction and part of the order parameter and not the phase. Then you change the phase, go another way around in order parameter space, and this disappears. The issue is here that this is not a simply connected order parameter space anymore.
So in your Mustal experiment, so it's is it a method to directly imagine the structure?
We have no microscopic information as of now. Maybe we will finally do some small angle neutron or so, but first one should look. I don't believe that it's really this short period helix. And they have claimed that this short period helix with a large angle between the spins, so not like I depicted here, but I believe that it may be may look really like this. Because in the diffraction experiments done so far, they cannot distinguish it. But this is just a conjecture. I mean, this is a test balloon. I just said we look for this and we make some conjecture that the phenomenological theory gives us some information that this should be anomalous, and they just looked. And then I said, okay, now we just try out what the community thinks about it. Because this is a topical material, it was not so easy. It's not so simple to convince people one should look carefully at what is really. But it's really something which would be not normal if it was just such a collinear spin density wave. That's in such a large temperature interval, something is magnetically already static on this 10 to the minus 6 to 8 seconds of the most power experiment. That was a success because I had this in mind and said, okay, just look, there should be something, and they found something. Then you say, okay, maybe theory is going to be helpful for something.
Any questions?
Jacob? Yeah, sorry. In the first three slides, I think, you started with the two ways you could get a modulated phase. One is with double Sensky-Morin interaction, and the other is with two exchange parameters, J1 and J2.
Yeah.
And so if you have a system that conjoins both of them, are the ground states still this side? So yeah. if you can combine both of them, do you still
if
have
the same? Exists certainly systems to this type. This is also a type of frustration, as you know. It frustrates a collinearity by this spin orbit kind of thing or length scale. This is would be something like a candid state, and you can be frustrated. And if you combine both, then you will have systems which exist for sure. For instance, beta manganese elemental anti-ferromagnetic order should belong to this class of systems. There's a such triangular arrangement, an anti-ferromagnetism, and it's still not understood, but it's also non-centrosymmetric. And to my mind, there were some calculations of spin orbit effects, but even in beta manganese, the magnetic order parameter, and nothing is really understood. And this is an elemental example where you have really this type of exchange frustration, also geometric frustration, this triangular arrangement of antiferromagnetic coupled entities, and this one combined. This can exist, and then you have a very massive magnetic system.
So the Dolzhinsky could be of exchange nature for triangular structures.
Because
for collinear, it's always slightly dependent.
The other thing is, because in principle, you always have all of these interactions in a system. So like you always have J1, J2, and up to.
This is idealization, and the only thing which helps you then to keep track which type of effects could be there would be, that's why I emphasize this, you should use Landau theory and look at these things. But in systems which are frustrated in that manner, or geometrically frustrated, antiferromagnetic with such triangular arrangement, it's even hard to know what is the other parameter then. And then, but still you would have also these terms then when they are eccentric. For instance, there are one-dimensional systems which have this type of frustration plus this one. And in that case, one sees really that the magnetic phase diagrams, for instance, can be very much. Really rigorous theory for such systems has not even been attempted, because you have simply too many orbit coupling parameters, and it's very difficult to do something meaningful for them. But it may be now worthwhile. Usually, you would like first to have the pure kind of cases secure, in reality, as I said, beta manganese is a prime example where I believe that you have this chiral solution schema coupling plus frustration intrinsically at the limits.
I have also a question. You talked about the solitons with zero or Brine magnetization. But usually in the mean field theory, we assume that this magnetization is formed due to some internal magnetic field. Mm-hmm. And how is this field compensated in these structures, or why? Why is M changes? Because of temperature or some internal?
Because of temperature. This theory where the states naturally arise, these are really rigorous numerical solutions. They look like this that you have. You see, I have just the usual Landau expansion here.
So the
entropy is here in the mode coupling term, and this holds then the whole thing, whether it's stiff or not stiff. This example where you have something similar, I forgot, this is Bulayevsky-Ginzburg mechanism for having the transformation of a block water easing one. It's exactly analogous, simple thing. Actually, you have a twisted texture or something like this. But it's simply that because this term here, the Lipschitz invariance is square, or this term is square, and this here is also squared, these two terms then finally start to really, if this is very small, start to compete with each other, and then the modulus becomes non-constant. This is really at the mean field level, just of theories already there.
Any more question? Or we will discuss it personally?
Yeah.
Okay, so.